Deadly bombings rocked Pakistan on the eve of a general election. The first blast took place at the office of an independent election candidate in Pishin district, leaving at least 16 people dead. Another explosion targeted an office of a religious party near the Afghan border, killing 12 people. The Islamic State has claimed responsibility for both attacks. Pakistan goes to the polls Thursday amid rising militant attacks and jailing from Imran Khan, the winner of the last election. No near truce in sight as Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu rejects a ceasefire proposal by Hamas. Netanyahu insists victory is within reach and only the total defeat of militants would ensure Israel's security. Hamas earlier responded to a proposed ceasefire deal for Gaza drawn up by U.S. and Israeli spy chiefs. The group offered a 4.5-month truce, which will include the release of all hostages in Gaza, the withdrawal of Israeli forces in the enclave, and an agreement to end the war. While it meets Israel's goal of releasing all hostages, agreeing to the deal would be a failure to dismantle Hamas, Israel's main pledge in the war. Despite the rejection, a Hamas delegation is set to travel to Cairo to pursue ceasefire talks with mediators Egypt and Qatar. A senior Hamas official also slammed Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, saying his insistence on continuing the war only confirmed his goal of committing genocide against Palestinians. He then called on the militants to keep on fighting. As for Washington, it remains optimistic the two sides can still reach a ceasefire deal.
We had an opportunity today to discuss with the Israeli government the response that Hamas sent last night to the proposal that the United States, Qatar, and Egypt had put together to bring the remaining hostages home and extend the humanitarian pause. What I can tell you about these discussions is that while there are some clear non-starters in Hamas's response, we do think it creates space for agreement to be reached. And we will work at that relentlessly until we get there.
Israel's war in Gaza, which has entered its fifth month, has killed at least 27,500 Palestinians. Only a week-long truce has been reached so far, which saw the release of around 100 hostages held by Hamas in exchange for the freedom of 240 Palestinians jailed in Israel back in November. The United Nations sounding the alarm over reports that the Israeli military intends to focus next on Rafah. UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres warns that move would only worsen what he called the humanitarian nightmare in the region. Since the war broke out, hundreds of thousands of Palestinians have fled to Rafah in a desperate search for safety from Israel's assault.
The situation in Gaza is a festering wound on our collective conscience that threatens the entire region. Nothing justifies the horrific terror attacks launched by Hamas against Israel on 7 October, nor is there any justification for the collective punishment of the Palestinian people. Yet, Israeli military operations have resulted in destruction and death in Gaza at a scale and speed without parallel since I became Secretary General. It's time for an immediate humanitarian ceasefire and the immediate and unconditional release of all hostages.
The death toll from the wildfires in Chile rises to 131. Over 300 others remain missing. The wildfires have burned over 9,700 hectares of land in various locations in the Valparaíso region. Meanwhile, authorities are investigating reports that some of the fires were started deliberately. Chile is under a state of emergency. A health alert has also been issued, along with curfews. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Hey guys, here are news making headlines for Filipinos in North America. Coming on the heels of British Columbia's tightened control on private post-secondary schools,
Filipino international students were given assurances during the second annual convention hosted by the Philippine Consulate General and the University of the Philippines alumni that they will be protected if their schools are closed down due to the crackdown. Recently, Canada announced the cap on the number of international students and BC's two-year ban on private post-secondary schools accepting applications from new enrollees.
Nag-worry lang ako dahil nga maraming linalabas ngayon ng mga updates tungkol sa mga international students. So gusto ko sanang updated din ako para sa mga incoming international student din.
But the BC Council for International Education assures students who are already in Canada not to be worried about the crackdown on private post-secondary schools.
If a school disappears tomorrow, the province and the other private institutions will guarantee that they will either school them out in a different school or get them some kind of a refund.
I think there is still room for us to come here. Ang importante is that when we come here, we come to the right schools.
This is the second one that we'll show, and it's a roll of 16mm film. So
let's go to Chicago, where Becky Hall of the Chicago Film Society is getting ready to show a film featuring a Filipino farm owner named Pablo Lacuata Cabellera and his family. Set in Reynoldsburg, Ohio in 1936, it's a silent film depicting a typical day at the farm. The film, shot by Philam Nicolas Viernes, is part of renowned Filipino Chicago historian Estrella Alomar's collection.
So what's really remarkable about this film is
Ashley Nakila with the Filipino American Historical Society of Chicago has taken up the mantle to preserve and present the archival footage in partnership with the Chicago Film Society and the University of Chicago Southside Home Movies Project.
People could see this and they can see pride in their own histories and pride in their own memories and representation through these films. Even if it's not their family, it's familiar.
And finally, behind these delectable dishes at one of the most historic hotels in Los Angeles is Filipino executive chef John Umali. The Biltmore is a 100-year-old icon of old Hollywood glamour and a venue for some of the biggest Los Angeles events, including award season ceremonies. It was the home of the Academy Awards during its early years. The hotel is a restaurant, cafes, and bar, and holds sizable banquets year-round. Chef John oversees around 150 employees, from cooks to servers to kitchen backup workers to cleaners.
I didn't go to school culinary. I started from the bottom. Prior going here sa US, sa Philippines, I didn't even cook. I worked my way up 16 years after. I'm here at the Biltmore and representing.
And those are the news-making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.